So good morning. This morning feels a bit like when I went to class in Pisa 9 a.m. on Friday morning, very precise. Luigi Ambrosio was always giving his course and he would pre-write a blackboard before I entered the room, which I found annoying, but now I repeat it. Okay, so that's the theorem I'd like to prove today. It's more or less the statement I gave you yesterday. I'll point out the differences. So, as we were saying yesterday, one way to approach the non-uniqueness is to find a U-bar that we call background, which by definition, it's a solution of Navier-Stokes with its own forms. So I didn't point it out. It has to be divergence free. And the property of the background is that LSS, which perhaps it's time to rewrite on the blackboard. It's the LSS is linearized Navier-Stokes in similar variables around U bar. It's this operator, this plus so minus Laplacian of U plus then I would have U bar dot grad U plus U dot grad U bar. And then I would have plus pressure. And adding a pressure is like, I can write it, sometimes it's convenient to think things as a Léré projection on divergence-free vector fields or the part of the part that is not divergence-free a priori. This really, I mean, for the scopes of today, if you just forget the pressure and this Léré projection, I mean, the proof you do would be the same, and then you add the pressure a posteriori. So if you are not too familiar with this, just forget Léré projections. Léré projections, in some sense, are invisible in Sobolev estimates, no? Because Calderon-Zinguend operator of order zero, you don't see it, and that's the only thing we will do. Okay. Somehow the pressure is always something that it's a huge problem if you want to do localized estimates. If you want to do global, typically it goes with the flow. Okay, once we found, so in this part we have to find an unstable eigenvalue. Here I added the word maximally. This I will need for point two, but maximally is somehow for free given the structure of this operator, let's say. So, because this operator, there is some abstract theory, operator theory, which says that operators of this form has a finite number, so a discrete set of unstable eigenvalues. So, and I mean, it's bounded, it cannot go to plus infinity. Okay. So we need to find an eigenvalue. Once we have found an eigenvalue, we can associate to it a solution of the linearized equation, the tau u equal LSS u. Whereas the original equation I wanted to solve has also a nonlinear term, u dot grad u. And that second point is the part where we want to reinsert it in the game, the nonlinear term. And our goal is to say that to find a solution of the nonlinear problem, I have to take the linear part from before and add something which is small in many norms with respect to the linear, to the Ulin. Okay. And okay, we play this game until a certain time t, which is so here we work from minus infinity. We need it a time t, which is just a numerical constant, let's say. It doesn't depend on any parameter, but it's fixed and very negative because we want a solution for short time, then there are and we apply Le Re theorem and we prolong it how much we want. Okay, the closeness here, we measure it. Yesterday I told you we measure it in HN norms. We have the smallness, so this would be the size of Yulin, so the extra epsilon makes it smaller. And yesterday I told you, in fact, a slightly stronger statement, because this one I will prove for a fixed n, for some n, with the property that is greater than 5/2. Now I tell you why. And yesterday, in reality, I told you that this estimate holds for any HK norm. So, yesterday I told you it holds for every HK norm. And here, instead of epsilon zero, you can put two real part of lambda, which is a stronger estimate. But the reality is that for technical reasons, you run the arguments like that for a fixed n and with a little bit of gain in the size, and then a posteriori you improve this. Once you have the existence and this estimate, you can improve it from Duhamel's formula. So, okay. Why n equal 5/2? Because Hn is an algebra. So that's a property. Since we will have to deal with the products of two things, and we will at a certain point bound norms of this thing, for n large enough, if you do the Hn norm of a product, it's the product. Okay. So let's do now the proof of part two. Which you will see, let's say it's an educated fixed point theorem. I mean, it's run in a bit of a borderline situation, maybe, but you can set it up in a reasonable way. Okay, so to apply a fixed point theorem, I need so a functional setting, a Duhamel identity that gives me the objects to which I want to apply the fixed point, and a contraction somewhere. And that's the ingredients I would like to take out. The functional setting is suggested by the type of estimate we want to prove. So the okay, maybe I should also comment that this second part has many, many analogies, even though the setting is not exactly the same with Gias-Verak arguments. So, okay. So the functional setting. I give you a norm, and then the space, as yesterday, is the one dictated by finiteness of the norm. Ux is the supremum over tau in minus infinity t, and then I want to embed the decay that I want, so I will have to put the Hn norm of u at time tau, and then I embed the decay. So I put e to the minus real part of lambda plus epsilon zero tau. Okay. So the functional space is the one in which this norm is finite. Then I need to find to what I apply the fixed point. So the fixed point will be in terms of the perturbation. So I have to find an equation for the perturbation from this equation. So this equation is telling me, so I write an equation for u per. So this equation, it's solved by, it has to be solved by Ulin plus u per. So I write it d tau Ulin plus d tau u per plus minus LSS Ulin minus LSS u per, and then plus four nonlinear terms. So let me make them explicit. There is Ulin against Ulin. Ulin dot, no, do I write? Dot grad Ulin. Then there is Ulin advecting u per. There is u per advecting Ulin. And there is the honest nonlinearity. Okay, this has to be equal to zero. Then, Ulin solves something, and that's very important. So this and this give zero. That's the equation for u per. We apply a Duhamel on it because, I mean, okay, let's stare at this equation. There is a linear term. If, like, I integrate this equation in time only, well, this guy is linear. I mean, it will never gain. There is no way it can gain. So I cannot integrate it. I have to put it into a Duhamel, no? I have to invert the linear operator. Then there is a nonlinearity. The nonlinearity from the point of view of u per has a part which is a forcing. I mean, this is given. And this dictates how much I can gain in the decay, no? Because, I mean, this is a forcing. If I apply the semigroup of LSS to this term, that one will be there. I mean, there will be no cancellation, nothing to hope for. So this dictates the fact that here I can gain a certain amount. Here I want to gain epsilon zero. In reality, I can gain two times because of this structure, but not more. Okay. And then this, so this is our biggest enemy, because if the thing works, so if I can close something on there, this guy will always have better estimates than this one. Okay, if I set up things properly. Because maybe the reality is Ulin, maybe as about Ulin, we know a lot of regularity. This eigenfunction, maybe I should have said it, this eigenfunction can be made pretty smooth, let's say H2, H3, H4. For the perturbation, well, it depends in which space I settle the fixed point, how much I can expect on it. Okay. So that's the structure of the equation. Are there questions? Because now let's do the details. So Duhamel. So Duhamel, as I said, I want to invert LSS. So it's the integral from minus infinity to tau of d to the tau minus s LSS. And then I have to put this stuff. So the layer projection of Ulin dot grad Ulin. So let me split it in three lines. Plus the projection, so forcing in terms of u per. Then linear then and this one is applied to all, and then quadratic. And then let me call the operator appearing on the first line. What's the name I gave? G. G is a G of tau. I mean, it doesn't depend on u per. Then a linear operator L u per. And a quadratic operator, where I'm calling this, of course, with the integral LSS. And same here, no? Tau minus s LSS apply to this. Okay, and this I call bilinear part. Okay. And now lemma or claim. I can make the norms, the appropriate norms of these guys, so g in x plus l as a linear operator from x to x, plus b as a bilinear operator from x cross x into x, small, so less than c, less than 1. Okay? And if this is done, so then, if now I call t of u, the sum of the three things appearing there, g plus l u plus b of u u, is a contraction. Why? Well, I can show you in one line, t of u minus t of v. Okay, the fixed, the part fixed, which is g, disappears. L of u minus v, I mean, I use it what I have here. And then for b, well, here I would have b of u u minus b of v v. But now I add and subtract, let's say, b of uv, yes. I use the bilinearity, and I obtain that this is bounded by the norm of L plus 2 times the norm of v times, so it's a contraction in v1, exactly, and I have u minus v, okay. In norm of u of x less than 1. And so in reality, there is, since I have a 2, better have a 2 there. Okay, so now this is a contraction if I prove this estimate, so then I can apply a fixed point theorem, find a solution. Okay. And maybe I should have said in the beginning of all this story, there are 2 parameters that I will fix, as it will be universal constants at a certain point, that are t and epsilon zero. This I will fix later. It will be t very negative and epsilon small. Okay. So we all agree that with a fixed point theorem plus this contraction I would find a solution u pair with the properties I want. So we are left to prove just the claim. Okay. And the claim, to prove the claim, I'll use one tool. So this comes again from the abstract. So in today, there will be several parts where you see a poor PD person using abstract machinery from operator theory. So here is one, and I'm not an expert on that, but there is a nice book like Engel and Nagel where you can find this kind of instruments. So the tool I will use is a growth estimate. I mean, it's nothing very fancy. And if you think it on finite matrices, it's very reasonable that if you consider the semigroup generated by an operator, so let's say the exponential of a matrix, and you apply it to an initial datum, and you want to control it in L2, so for matrices, this cannot grow faster than the highest eigenvalue. So lambda is our maximal eigenvalue. So if the maximal eigenvalue dictates the growth of the matrix is probably not entirely correct because there can be Jordan blocks. And so the correction is that you have a delta. Okay, and so and then a constant depending on delta. Okay, but for any delta, there exists at delta such that this growth estimate on the semigroup works. Okay, and now there is something which we proved. So here it would be L2, L2, but LSS has a Laplacian inside. The Laplacian is regularizing, and somehow an argument to couple the right growth in tau with the regularization effect of the Laplacian, which means that this estimate, I have it L2, L2, but in reality, I have it also gaining derivatives. So like in Hn plus 1 against Hn, with the price to pay what you would pay for a Laplacian, which is a square root, a square root of tau. No. Now I'm perplexed by this estimate. Is that correct? Tau is very negative, exactly. So it's not. So
let me.
Ah, yes, correct. Thanks. That's what's worse. Thanks a lot. Yes, so it's correct. Okay. Now let's use this information to bound our terms. I start from, the linear term or the force. Maybe the force is really what dictates a lot of things. So let's start from G. So I have to estimate the X norm. So let me estimate Hn and hope to find a decay better than e to the tau re lambda. So G in Hn is bounded. So G is there. I apply minus infinity to tau, then I would have the norm. So then I have the semigroup applied to this guy. Here inside I'm losing one derivative, and so I want to gain it back with this estimate. And this is why this estimate is with the n plus 1, but in reality also with the n plus 100, and here you would have a power 100 over the square root of tau. But I use it with 1 because my equation is losing derivative on the way. Okay. So now I want to use. So I want to apply this with Hn, and I want to go to Hn minus 1 in reality. So let me write it like this. This is what I'm using. So I want to. I am applying the Hn norm of what is inside, and I get the Hn minus 1 norm of Yulin dot grad Yulin in Hn minus 1. And then I get the whatever is here. So a constant that I don't write, e to the real part of lambda plus delta tau minus s divided by square root of time tau minus s. Okay, this Hn minus 1 norm is a product of things, so I can bound it with Yulin in Hn squared thanks to the algebra structure. Here I lose a derivative, so I go to Hn, I go back to Hn. But now Yulin is explicit, this is e to the 2, so this, okay, all this is evaluated at time s, and then I integrate in the S. So you, this time S is what? It's e to the 2, because there is a 2 here, 2 real part of lambda S. And then there is the HN norm of the eigenfunction, which is a number. Okay. And then when you do an integral like, so here you have, okay, there is a part that goes out, no? E to the real lambda plus delta. Then you have a power of S, which is positive, which is 2 real part minus a real part minus delta. And then you have a correction which does nothing because you are against exponentials. There's no hope, so you get overall what? 2, yes. So there is no delta anymore, in fact. 2 tau. Okay. So, and this is, this factor is then. Okay, and the only thing I used in that estimate, I need to choose delta in such a way to be smaller than the real part of lambda that I had. By the way, yesterday I gave an answer which was not correct. I was thinking to another thing. The eigenfunction has to be detached from zero, like has to be greater than one. But what we will see from the next part is that this counts for free. So. Because instead, when you want the eigenfunction only for the Euler equation, you get an unstable one and then you can make it big just by multiplying by a large constant in the background. So yesterday I gave an imprecise answer on this point. So this is a parenthesis. Okay, so now we have this, and this is what we need in order to put in the norm. And something which is small. So it will be real part of lambda minus epsilon zero tau. Okay. And this, it can be made as a number very much smaller than one, arbitrarily small, provided I choose t very negative. Okay, so this is a small constant times the part that I have to put in the norm x. Okay. Then, maybe I show you the linear part, and the bilinear is somehow a variation of this, and also the linear is a variation of the estimate we already did in reality. But if I have to estimate the linear part at time tau in HN, what do I do? Well, in reality, the same thing that I did there. No, I have to estimate the integral from minus infinity to tau of the semigroup. I do the same computation. No, I lose a constant, then I have e to the real part of lambda plus delta tau divided by tau 1 s to the 1/2, and then I have the norm of what is left, u lin dot grad u plus u dot grad u lin in h n minus 1, and here I use the algebra property to go above with u lin in h n, u in hn, all at time s. And then I have u lin as an explicit decay, as before, in s, so it's e to the real part of lambda s. And u, well, I'm assuming, I have to control this with the norm in x of u. So I can say that this is less than e to the real part of lambda plus epsilon zero, coming from the S, norm of u in x. Okay. And Yeah, well, and this the number that you are integrating, I mean, the quantity that you are integrating there in S is smaller than the one that you saw there. So. Tomorrow's S. Thanks. Okay, so this is smaller again, then it will be smaller than e to the real part of lambda. Let me double check. So 2 real part of lambda plus epsilon zero even, so it's smaller than before, norm of u tau, norm of u in x. Then a part of this you put, so then a part of this you put to estimate. So L U in X is controlled by I have to multiply by a factor dictated by the norm. So e to the minus real lambda plus epsilon zero tau. I multiply it here, I take it out there. So I get this less than e to the real lambda t, the maximum t possible, norm of u in x. And now I make this quantity small, this is capital T. So now I make this quantity small, provided capital T is chosen very negative. And b is the same. I mean, here I did the g, l of u, and B is really the same estimate. In a sense, B is even smaller, no? Because B has the same structure as here, but there is U pair instead of U lin. And U pair is smaller than U lin in the argument we are running, so cannot create problems. Okay. So this concludes the nonlinear proof. Are there questions? Yes.
Why do you use the epsilon zero? I don't really understand what is the role of this.
I mean, because you would take epsilon zero equal to real part of lambda, right? This would be your. I mean, that one is the biggest you can allow. I mean, it's here if you want to take this small. I need epsilon zero to be less than the real part of lambda. For sure. So. Yes, I need it to be there, because otherwise that one is not integrating, I guess. No.
The semigroup, you require epsilon zero to be positive to have the semigroup estimate. It's not a tool, it's just a constraint. The gross estimate on the top would not be true with the type of zero.
Yes, that's the case. Okay. Are there other questions? Okay. If not, we go to part one. Part one is a bit longer to prove, so what I will tell you about part one is a strategy to develop the proof. Then we will see that there is one tool which is fundamental, because we will always proceed by sort of approximating in various ways our problem with another one, and we will want to transfer spectral information from one to the other. So in particular, statements like if there is an unstable eigenvalue for that operator, then these other operators that are approximating will eventually have the same spectral, like unstable eigenvalue. Okay. So this will be a tool that is common to the various parts of the proof. And so then I will prove, or I will prove this tool on a toy model, on a toy problem that you will see. Okay. So, so we look for unstable eigenvalues of LSS. So LSS depends on a fixed U bar, and it's a linear operator in terms of U. Let me write it explicitly. And this LSS is there, it's minus 1/2, 1 plus xi dot grad, U, Laplacian of U, and then a Léré projection of U bar dot grad, più U dot grad, U bar. Okay. And the first observation that I already did quickly yesterday is that I want to find this U bar unstable. Well, I can always think that I fix a U bar and then I put a large constant in front of X of it. The large constant would reflect only here, well, on these two terms. Okay. But then I can interpret it as I take it out, let's say. So then I have the first part with a 1 over beta and the outside with a times beta. The times beta side doesn't change the property of having a stable eigenvalues. It only possibly makes it them bigger. No? If I 1 over beta inside suggests that if I take beta very large, well, this is the part of the operator that is ruling the behavior. If I find an unstable object for that part, I can hope that this operator plus a small perturbation has the same spectral behavior. Okay. So out of this argument, let's say, so the new goal find unstable eigenvalue for that part of the operator, which we can call linearized 3D Euler. So U bar advecting U, U advecting U bar. Okay. So we have linearized 3D Euler. And then we go to look into the literature. What is our favorite unstable object in 3D, which is truly 3D. You cannot take a 2D object and like a shear flow, an unstable shear flow, and extend it in one variable because these are not Léré. I mean, then the kinetic energy is infinite. It's not decaying. So you need something truly 3D. Our goal is then compactly supported in R3. So we look to this problem, and you don't find in the literature, or at least we didn't. And then we say, okay, let's look at a simpler problem. So we started from 2D Euler. And for reasons that will be immediately clear, so this in principle is the operator for which we want instability, but in 2D now, okay? And there are reasons why it's convenient to write it in, taking the curl of this operator and finding its stability in vorticity formulation. The reason, so look for instability. So not of this operator, but of an operator that we read taking the curl of it, of, stability, of linearized Euler in vorticity formulation, which applies to a vorticity omega, which is a scalar, and gives the u bar dot grad omega. Should I write it? Yes, u bar dot grad omega, so, u bar dot grad omega plus u dot grad omega bar. So what are these two objects? Omega bar is the curl of our background, and u is, so this is an operator of omega, and u is found by omega from the Biot-Savart, 2D Biot-Savart law. Okay. Why it's convenient to look at this operator? Because there are several nice properties. This is a transport term, which we will call main part of the operator. Yes, now you see why. Main of omega. And has the property to be, so it's a transport, so it's a skew adjoint. As a spectral property, so the spectrum can only lie on the imaginary axis. And the other part, this one, gains a derivative in terms of omega and thinks that gain a derivative in appropriate spaces are compact. Okay. So the property, the structural properties of this operator is, this one is skew adjoint in particular, so it's the main part of the operator, I think it's like that, but it's also, for instance, I can explicitly invert him or like lambda minus m. It's, these are things that you can explicitly invert due to the transport structure. And k is compact as an operator of omega. Okay, so in particular, for instance, k doesn't blur the essential spectrum. Which in topic in which I will not enter much, but which is under the carpet. Okay. Then, in 2D, for 2D Euler, there are two classes of, say, backgrounds for which stability and instability are well understood. And these are shear flows and vortices. So let, now, u bar be a 2D vortex. So a 2D vortex radially symmetric means u bar of x is of the form. So is x perp, let me see how I wrote it, x perp times a function of the distance. The associative vorticity omega bar, which is the curl of an object of this type, is a radial function. Okay. So this is the kind of backgrounds we want to consider. These backgrounds are solutions. So they solve stationary to the Euler. Then you may wonder why in the end they generate a force. Well, because we want to look at them as self-similar solutions, and they are not self-similar solutions, so they have a force associated to them. Okay. For this kind of solutions, there are classical words, really, in the 18th century. Proved for shear flows, but the same works for vortices, that G monotone implies that the operator L4 is stable. So no way to find a monotone profile G which makes the job. And here it's where one of the results in Vishik paper onto the Euler enters into play. Vishik, in order to study the sharpness of Yudovich theorem, builds a G which is not monotone and for which the operator is unstable. So let me see. Yes, so let me state it like this. There exists a G such that L4 associated to this vortex is unstable. How is G done for Vishik? Okay, G is the profile for R positive, so let me write R. The profile of Vishik is something like quadratic behavior around zero. Then non-monotone, so like a sort of bump. And then power law decay. Okay. This is G. Okay. And okay, to be honest, I mean, as I was saying, Vishik, to my knowledge, is the first to build an unstable vortex, but there were previous results by Tolmien and I don't know when, maybe in the 60s, and then Jiwalin in the early 2000s, maybe, this one. I don't know, you know. Boom. More or less. Where shear flows were understood and unstable shear flows were built. Essentially, things like sine of nx times ey is an unstable shear flow. So this one before was unstable shear flows. But Vishik, to do his theorem in 2D, also cannot rely on something which is as a direction of invariance. So a vortex is needed, and that's what it means. Okay. Okay. At this point, what is our strategy? So this I take for granted. I'll not comment on it because, I mean, there is work to do to prove this, but then our strategy is first take Vishik vortex and make it compactly supported. So we want to modify Vishik vortex, maintaining the instability, but making it to zero. So make Vishik vortex compactly supported. Okay. Second point is to, okay, because now we have a 2D compactly supporting things, how do we go to 3D? And here I'll make a picture. So in 2D, we have this vortex, which is something that rotates, let's say, around the origin. Well, I can move it. I can make it rotate at a distance L. So here I have Vishik vortex, which is something that rotates like this. Vishik's compactly supported version, let's say. Okay. And then I embed it in 3D by rotating it around the vertical axis. So now this becomes the Z direction, this is the X direction, the Y direction comes out here, and this guy starts making a tour around the Z axis. And so L is very large. Okay. Why there is hope that this guy is unstable? Okay. This so the second point is go to 3D Euler by rotating whatever we got in one. Okay. Okay, plus corrections, no? Because when you take a 2D object and you rotate it, you're not anymore divergent free. So, plus something. Okay, why is this reasonable? Well, for this, so we go to 3D Euler, but doing this operation, we go to 3D Euler with several symmetries. Let's exploit the symmetry. So this object this object is in the class of solutions of Euler, which are axisymmetric norm. Axisymmetric norm. Which means the following. I can write a solution of Euler in polar coordinates. Polar coordinates are very well adapted, so not polar, cylindrical coordinates. So I want to write the solution U as, so U as a function of R theta Z. In principle, this has three components, no? U as a UR component, plus a u theta component, plus a u z component, and all three are a function of r theta and z. The symmetry that I impose, and that is true for my object, is that, so there is no theta dependence in anything. Yes. And, yes, are there questions? So there is no theta dependence, and there is no theta component of the vector field. And correspondingly, when you look at the curl of an object like that, is only in the E theta direction. So maybe here you would have liked to write UR, ER, E theta, E zeta, so that these are scalars, and these detect the directions. And then omega, at this point of R and zeta, R is an omega theta of R z in the direction E theta. Okay, and also, for instance, the stream function psi, so the inverse Laplacian of this will be correspondingly a psi theta in the direction E theta. Okay. So under these symmetries, Euler rewrites in the following way. So this is a 3D Euler axisymmetric no swirl. So there is, are there questions?
Yes, what is psi?
Psi is the stream function, so it's the inverse Laplacian. Okay, so exactly, Write the stream function. So let's write an equation for the stream function. It's the Laplacian in polar, in cylindrical coordinates, which will be drr plus 1 over r dr plus over 1 over r squared d theta theta. Sorry, I hope. No, of course, theta is not there, sorry, it's 1 over r, minus 1 over r squared plus dzz, psi theta equal omega theta. So this is the stream function. The velocity field via Savart-Loer, I find it by taking the gradient of this psi theta, but in cylindrical coordinate, which means that U, which is the sum of an ER part and an EZ part, is obtained as in the ER part is minus dZ psi, and then I have ER, and the in the EZ part, it has a correction, it's a dR plus 1 over R. Okay? And the vorticity solves Euler in vorticity, so it has a time derivative of the vorticity, the component theta only, this is the only one. It has a transport part, u dot grad omega theta, and it has a stretching term, which is what? It's like 1 over r. And then I should put Yes, u dot grad, and then there is u r over r omega theta. Okay. And now the observation is that this equation formally we read to the Euler. So to the Euler is written in this equation. If for a moment I imagine to forget this term, to forget these other terms, because I want a 2D thing, no? So and to the Euler is in the r zeta variables. So if I forget this extra term, I see a transport equation for omega theta. If I forget this extra term, I see the classical Laplacian in 2D of psi equal omega theta. If I forget this term, I see the classical form where u is the gradient perp of psi. Okay? So forgetting the box, the things, I see to the Euler in R zeta plane. Okay. And now I stare at the things that I want to forget, and I observe that they all have a 1 over R factor. And our vortex is supported at a very large distance, L, from the origin. So 1 over r is expected on the support of my vortex to be very small. So this is why there is hope, again, to do a perturbation argument, which would say that since I have an unstable eigenvalue when I forget these extra terms, well, I can reinsert them because they are small. So we hope that to the Euler instability can be transferred to 3D axis. Okay. So now it comes the moment where so now I gave you the full plan. We have take Vishik vortex. First step, make it compactly supported and hope to maintain the instability. Second step, rotate it and go to 3D and hope to maintain the instability. Third step, re-add back Laplace and parts of the operator that we hope to be small. All this must rely on a general way of thinking, which is that you can perturb stuff, your background, the operator or so, and still maintain the instability. So this is not completely for free. This is not for free, let's say. But it's something that one can hope in several situations. And all these situations will require, for instance, some regularity, because, for instance, you want to add back a Laplacian. If your eigenvalue was not differentiable, then for sure you would have problems. Okay, so now let me give you a toy problem for spectral perturbation. I'm sorry, I wrote it. Okay. So spectral perturbation. A toy problem. Okay. So the toy problem I want to prove is it's not here really. Okay. Okay. Lemma. If I have let lambda infinity unstable eigenvalue for an operator that I will call L infinity, which is what we reduced to. It's that one for a u bar that I call u bar infinity. So it's u bar dot grad, so L infinity of omega, u bar dot grad omega plus u, where u is the Biot-Savart law of omega, dot grad omega bar. And the u bar omega bar are infinity, so I call them u infinity and omega bar infinity. It's vorticity. And now I want to approximate them smoothly, so let so let uk bar, which converge to u infinity bar in all the derivatives you want, c3. So you converge very smoothly. And let lk be the associated operator. Operator as in this formula, now with k in place of infinity. Okay, then. Okay, for every epsilon which has to be smaller than the real part of lambda infinity. Okay, for every epsilon small. Yes, maybe in this toy problem, let's assume. Then in reality, we want to, yes. Then for every epsilon small, for kappa sufficiently large, there exists lambda kappa eigenvalue of L kappa such that it's close to lambda infinity. So in particular, if lambda infinity was unstable, so real part positive is less than epsilon, also lambda kappa would be. Okay. So this is the last thing I'm doing at this point. You see, sorry?
It's 2D or 3D?
2D, yes, 2D because the operator, I need structure on the operator, yes. I mean, and morally, this way to do spectral perturbation is particularly close to the step one here, where you take something which is decaying already as r to the minus alpha, you multiply by a large cutoff, a cutoff at scale BR very large. Well, you are something that is very close to what we are doing there. Okay. Okay, to do this proof, we need some instruments from operator theory, which I will try to state clearly and definitely not prove. So let's draw our situation. So our situation in the complex plane, there is this, this is C. For L infinity, the limit operator, we have an unstable eigenvalue, lambda infinity. And we know, thanks to the structure, so, because then there is other parts of the spectrum around. What can they be? Well, they can be other points in the unstable part, in the real positive real part. And then there could be stuff, much more fishy stuff, for instance, living on the axis, essential spectrum due. But the essential spectrum is, whatever happens before in this part of the space, I don't care. For me, there could be all spectrum, and I don't care. I care a lot about what happens here, and here I need to know from abstract nonsense, let's call it. I hope not to offend any operator theory. But it's very abstract stuff that this operator has only discrete eigenvalues. Okay. Once I have only discrete eigenvalues, all this is to make a curve that surrounds one eigenvalue, remains in the part of strictly positive real part, and doesn't pass over any other part of the spectrum, really. Okay. And this is very important. I mean, we have a real concrete situations for 2D Euler, where you have unstable part of the spectrum. It has been proved in several works of Ishik or so. But we cannot use it to run this kind of arguments, because there is no spectral stability around. The essential spectrum is very fishy. I mean, it's difficult to put the hands on it. Instead, what we need for the argument that I canceled and was at the beginning of the argument is really an eigenvalue. A single isolated eigenvalue. For the moment, we cannot do without. Okay. So we circle this eigenvalue, as I was saying. And then, let me call C, curly C, this curve that surrounds my eigenvalue. At all these points, the information I have is that if I take a lambda on this curve, And I do lambda minus L infinity, this is an invertible operator, because it's, otherwise it would be in the spectrum. Okay. And then, so let's do the proof. Then there is a fact of operator theory that we use, that is that the fact that if you have an operator L and a curve that is here doesn't intersect the spectrum, you can define a spectral projection, which is you define this operator P of omega, which by definition is 1 over 2 pi I, so, and then I integrate on the curve, the resolvent of lambda L in d lambda, where the resolvent is simply the inverse of lambda minus L. And this, we said, is invertible because the curve is not intersecting the spectrum. Okay, P with this property, then the fact is that P is non-trivial, so non-zero, if and only if there exists an eigenvalue inside the contour. Inside the curve C. Okay. So now, what is the plan? So at this point, what I want to show, we claim that P kappa, the spectral projection that you can associate to the operator L kappa, converges well enough to P. Well, converges well enough pointwise. So for every omega, okay, let me not specify too much the domains, otherwise we get crazy. So I need the convergence P kappa of omega to P of omega. If this is the case, the limit is non-trivial, then P kappa must be non-trivial for kappa large enough, and so there is an eigenvalue inside. Okay. And so this would end the proof. Okay. How do we do this argument? Let's say, okay, to get the convergence of this, I do a further reduction, in fact, it is enough to prove, so the spectral projection is defined as an integral of a curve of a compact set of the resolvent, so I need convergence of the resolvents, locally uniform in lambda. So I need that the resolvent of lambda L kappa, which by definition is lambda minus L kappa to the minus one, converges, so applied to any omega, converges to the resolvent of lambda L infinity applied to omega, and this convergence has to be locally uniform in lambda in such a way that we can then integrate it on the contour and pass to the limit to get that one. Okay. And this is lambda minus L infinity to the minus one applied to omega. Okay. The first lemma that I'll prove now, so now we use a lot of small information about how the operator is done. So the operator has, as I said, a main part, M infinity of omega, and a compact part, K infinity of omega. So let's first invert M infinity. So lambda, what do you want to say? That lambda minus mk to the minus 1 applied to omega 0 converges to lambda minus m infinity, the minus 1 applied to omega 0. So for every omega 0 in L2, and with some uniformity in lambda. And this, the proof of this lemma, luckily, relies on the, really the explicit nature of this operator, because this is a transport equation. So if you want, you can really write down who is the solution of this Zagai. I mean, the inverting this is just composing with the flow. I'll give you the fancy proof in operator theory language, but you can translate it in how to solve a transport equation, basically. So the fancy proof is that if you have this, you have the Laplace transform characterization of the resolvent. Take it, I mean, it's a very general fact, but we use it in a very stupid case in reality, which says that this is e to the minus lambda t plus tmk, so e tmk omega 0 in dt. And then you observe that doing the applying this the semigroup of this mk is just composed with the flow. So here I can take this out and compose with the flow at minus t. The flow of the velocity field uk, which generates mk. Okay. And then basically the flow converges. So there is stability of the flows. This converges. Omega zero, so the flow converges, and also somehow the exponential factor here in front, because lambda is positive real part, helps in dealing with the fact that we are integrating on zero infinity, so two dominated convergence.
Can you explain again the
arguments for the flow? Yeah, I mean, these flows, so you have to pass the limit this formula to get an analogous formula with x infinity here in place of xk. But the flows converge.
Okay.
So. Okay. And then there is a final argument. Sorry, how late is it? I have still 5 minutes. Okay. So now we want, in reality, to invert. So here we have inverted the lambda minus mk. In reality, we want to invert lambda minus lk. Lk is the sum of mk plus a compact perturbation. So, and I want to write this as. So this lk is mk plus the compact part k. I want to write it as lambda. This part I know it's invertible. And then I have what is left. So this is identity plus lambda minus mk to the minus 1, and then the compact operator. Okay. So I want to show that this guy is invertible. This one it is. So I have to show that this compact perturbation of the identity is invertible. I need identity plus lambda minus mk invertible. Okay. First of all, I verify it is invertible for k equal infinity. Well, because invertibility of this operator means that there is no solution of this equal to zero. Is if and only if there is no solution to this is equal to zero. But a solution to this equal to zero is also a solution when I reapply this, if I get zero, infinity, thanks, invertible. Right, I mean, if this is invert, yeah, I mean, yeah, they should be equivalent, which is invertible because lambda is not in the eigen, it's not an eigenfunction because it's on the contour, see? And the contour doesn't meet eigenvalues. Okay. So let's write true. Okay, and then I want to pass the information that the one for k equal infinity is invertible to the k large case. For that, I want a nice enough convergence, right? Because invertibility, I mean, invertibility is not a property stable by pointwise convergence of operators, no? Strong convergence, I did like operator convergence, something stronger. But here I can exploit the fact that a compact operator, to some extent, it's like sending you in a finite dimensional space. So up to a small approximation argument. So, fact, again, abstract fact, k infinity is a compact operator, then I can approximate it with a sequence that I call fj that converge to k infinity, and fj are finite dimensional, no, a finite rank. Why I do this? Because then so then the resolvent of so I want to apply lambda minus mk to the minus one. This one by the lemma, I know it exists and I know it converges by this lemma, pointwise. Pointwise, though. But then I apply it with fj. Fj has finite rank, so upgrades pointwise convergence in operator convergence. So this one, lambda minus m infinity. Here we all agree that this happens pointwise. No, I'm composing converging operator with something that converges pointwise, but then since in reality this operator I'm applying on a finite dimensional space, well, pointwise convergence is like is operator convergence. So in operator norm. Okay. And then sorry? Sorry, so fj, correct. So j fixed. So for every j fixed, I upgrade to operator convergence. Right. And this and And now I move j to get that lambda minus mk to the minus 1 k now I'm confused. So now this passes to j equal j to infinity, k infinity. Yes, and here I need these ones to be uniformly bounded, which is something that you get again from the explicit expression of the inverse with the flow. And finally, yeah, and the last observation to arrive here, let me write it in this corner, is that lambda minus mk to the minus 1 kk, and the other one converge, lambda minus mk, then k, I have k infinity, this one converges in operator norm. Okay. In any case, the argument is really, I mean, there are several things, several structural things that we used in this that amount essentially in a main part of the operator, which is whose resolvent is explicit in terms of the flow. So we know many things about its convergence, plus a compact perturbation that somehow makes things finite dimensionals in a certain sense. Okay, with this I stop.